how's everybody doing?
Good.
I know we have invitations led by Councilman Ryan Guy.
Everyone, please bow your heads. Dear Father, I pray that you will help every member of our community to live with harmony with each other. May we be united in love and enable us to pray with the mind of Christ, to be guided by the Spirit of God, and to glorify you with the heart and voice. Keep us from our worldly ways, but rather may our lives be a witness of your love, not only in what you say, but in all that we do. I ask this for the sake of Jesus Christ, my Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can I get a motion to approve the minutes of the February 15th council meeting?
I make a motion that we approve the minutes. I'll second.
Any discussion? All in favor of the motion, the minutes being received, that's going to say aye. Ladies have the same rights, motion approved. Okay, approval of the meeting agenda. Make a motion.
I move that we approve the agenda for tonight.
Second that.
Any discussion? It's been properly moved and seconded that we receive the meeting agenda. All in favor, that's going to say aye. Ladies have the same rights. Okay, our reports. Ms. Lisa Robb.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council. The DDRA invites businesses to network and learn about the DDRA programs and give feedback for future projects at our monthly members' breakfast at 8 a.m. Wednesday, March 28th at Taki's Diner. Breakfast will be provided for member businesses at no charge. Non-members who would like to attend the meeting are welcome for a nominal donation of $5 towards the meal. These meetings will be held on the last Wednesday of each month at 8 a.m. through October at Taki's. The annual Taste of Darlington is coming up. It's going to be held on Thursday, April 12th at the track Too Tough to Tame from 7 to 9 p.m. in the infield garage area. We're accepting grillers, table hosts, and sponsors for this fabulous evening of food and fun. So far, attendees will have a host of delicious food to sample, including wild game, ribs, a vegan buffet, catfish, and more. The Taste, being held on the second Thursday in April, leads into our 2018 season of Bringing Downtown Alive free concerts that will be held on the second Thursday of the month, May through August. And we will also have a free concert on the Friday of Race Week at Liberty Lane and Pearl Street. The lineup includes Johnny Glenn and the Chasers on May 10th to kick off the series, as well as a cruise-in by the Darlington Cruisers car show. The Bout Time Band of Darlington will play on June 14th. Dustin James and Hank Edwards will play on July 12th. We will hold a community karaoke party on August 9th. And Radio Vibe will wrap up the season on August 31st. The concert committee is in the process of securing additional sponsors. Pepsi of Florence and Wilson Senior Care have already committed to assisting us with this project. And anyone who's interested in helping to organize the concerts should call my office or come to the next concert committee meeting at Mama Mia's at 5:30 p.m. Tuesday, March 27th. Any questions? Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Greater Chambers, Harriet Miles.
Good evening. Longer report than normal one, and I apologize. I'm very pleased to announce that as of January, we have a grand total of 12 new or reestablished chamber members. This is a wonderful growth for our chamber. However, we need to keep the momentum growing. So if you as an individual or your business is not a chamber member, eye contact for the city council members, please contact me to join. Every membership is vital to our town. I am also pleased to announce that within the last 2 days, I've had 3 businesses to come into the chamber to inquire about opening businesses in our town.
All right, now.
But more particularly on the square.
I'll hear you.
I have told them of the buildings and personally taken them around the square and showed them of the buildings that I knew that were for sale, and then I gave them leasing information so they could get some additional information on the grants, the incentives, and some additional commercial businesses or buildings that were for sale.
Good.
Events. I would like to thank everyone that came to the annual banquet on February the 1st at the Country Club. This event is always special to the Chamber as it acknowledges people for their accomplishments throughout the year and years. It was a great success in our eyes, and the speaker was just phenomenal. Some of our upcoming events. On March the 24th, the Greater Darlington Chamber of Commerce and the Darlington County Rec Commission will host an Easter egg hunt on the courthouse grounds beginning at 11 o'clock. This is a free event for our community. The Easter Bunny's gonna get up pretty early that morning and hide about 1,000 Easter eggs for all the children to find. We will have 2 golden eggs for each of the different age groups. You're gonna see some banners hanging around town that look like this.
You discriminate against us seniors.
Now, if you want to come and find some of the eggs, you just can't find any golden eggs. But no, I won't discriminate against seniors because this Easter Bunny is going to be a senior. But it's a free event. So please let all the children that you know, any of your kids, grandchildren, let them know that it is a free event, because there's 1,000 eggs that are going to be hidden. And I do not want to hide them and then have to go pick them back up. Bow ties and pearls. This is a new event for our chamber, and it's going to be held on Saturday, April the 21st, beginning at 6:30. We will have live music, good barbecue, sweet tea, or adult beverages for those of you who imbibe. If you prefer a lot of dancing and visiting, the backyard of South Pearl is where you need to be on the night of the 21st. Tickets are only $15 a person.
Where about now?
South of Pearl.
South of Pearl. Well, it's in the backyard.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You're going to start to see posters and banners around town looking like this, but in much, much larger form. We've calculated exactly what the rent on South of Pearl is going to be, what each plate of barbecue is costing us, and what the band is costing us. And that's what each ticket is. Then divide it out to be $15. So it's all barbecue you can eat, as long as you're not going to eat me out of house and home. Come eat barbecue, drink some sweet tea, listen to a really good band, dance in the backyard. And have
okay.
Beg your pardon?
You gotta think about the blood pressure. You eat too much of that barbecue.
Well, then you go see. Then you just take blood pressure.
And you'll be able to.
And you dance it off. It'll all be good after
that. All right,
that.
So that means you got the wobble.
I watched you, Elaine. That's old. Now, in partnership with the Florence Chamber of Commerce.
Yes.
We are hosting a luncheon for the Administrative Professionals Day on Wednesday, April the 25th. Right. It is being held at the SIMT building. The speaker that they have booked this year is apparently hysterically funny, so you will be there to be entertained. We have over 100 door prizes and at least 20 vendors with giveaways. It will be a wonderful event for all who attend. I hope everyone's company will support the chamber and send your administrative personnel to this event, designed especially to say a very sincere thank you to those who make our lives easier.
What was that time frame?
What did you say? April 25th.
April 25th. It starts at 11 o'clock for the vendors and the exhibitors, and then lunch and a program at 12. And you can contact me or Liz at the Chamber for tickets. Now, we're doing something on May the 10th that is totally different. I don't know if anyone has heard the talk about Open House Darlington.
Yes.
We're very excited about this. We have contacted realtors, owners of vacant buildings on the square and in Darlington. We're getting them to sweep them out, brush them up, put a little spit shine on them, and we're going to have an open house, or a realtor, sort of like a realtor's caravan. And we are inviting people, we are advertising it in Atlanta, Charlotte, Columbia, Greenville, Spartanburg, Charleston, Miami, Atlanta, Southern Living, and Garden and Gun. And we are going to have people walking through our town, looking at our properties. And we want them to see our dream. You know, if somebody wants to open up a business, why go to Greenville, where you're going to pay higher taxes? The people aren't as nice. Trust me, they're just not as nice as we are. We have a beautiful town. We're an historic town. We love our town. And if you don't believe us, the chamber has a sign that says so. We love Darlington. You just have to dream with us. We have the dream. And you just have to take that ride with us. And we're going to have people showing off our town. And hopefully, May the 10th.
Thursday.
Yes, sir. And we're going to have one of the trolleys from PDRTA doing an historical tour. We've got someone who's going to take people around if they want to do a tour of our beautiful town. Listen to the history. You know, I've said in Southern Living, tour our town, smell the magnolia. Hopefully something's blooming other than pollen. You know, look at our smiling faces. Have a glass of sweet tea with us and just dream my dream. And then at the end of the day, come back to the chamber for a cocktail reception. Talk about it. Let's wrap it up. We'll have hopefully some bankers there. We'll have all of the codes from Lisa. We'll have the incentives, all of the grant information. We're going to give more information than they ever wanted to know about Darlington. I've been researching all the historical information on these buildings. And then after that, we've got the first concert at Liberty Lane. So we're hoping people will fall in love with our town. And if not, we've gotten great exposure. If nothing else, people will leave here knowing what a wonderful town we are and what wonderful people we are. And as always, we're in the planning stages of Freedom Fest. And that's my long, lengthy report. Any questions?
Great job. I like your plan.
Thank you.
Now, Freedom Fest,
are you going to ask us for money for Freedom Fest this year?
Of course I am.
When are you going to do that?
Can I do it now during my report?
Yeah.
I sent a letter to
That's
you.
That's why I was wondering. I thought we'd you pre-ready.
I want money. I am here.
We all do.
I sent Mr. Garland a letter requesting the city for the same contribution that they gave us last year.
All right. Now tell us why you need the money and what happened last year, so everybody know what happened last year.
Well, the fireworks didn't go off, right? Because the fireworks company did not do what they were supposed to do. When they were setting, they came in several hours late, and they were chasing themselves trying to set them up. They did not cover them, and so they got rained on. And they told Chief Kavanaugh that they were ruined. And if pyrotechnics get wet, when they dry out again, you can't cannot reshoot them because they can blow up in your face. So we chose not to set a reset date. We didn't want to use those and run the risk of someone getting maimed. But the contribution from the city was not for fireworks. It was a presenting sponsor. Freedom Fest was presented by the city of Darlington, is how it was billed. And that money was used for we have to rent the racetrack. It cost us $11,000 to hold Freedom Fest at the racetrack. Because we have to rent the track, we have to purchase tickets for the race, we have to use EPI security. We have to have additional security, which I'm glad we did, because at the first clap of thunder, EPI took cover, and our sheriff's department had to suit up and get the cars to exit. That's $11,000 almost in itself. We have to rent porta potties. We have to rent dumpsters. And this is just to have it there. So it's a wonderful facility and we're awfully proud of it. But it's a cost to use it and maintain it. So, but that's not what the city paid for. It just went into the lump general fund for Freedom Fest. And band and our children's rides were over $20,000. But the kids love them.
Me too.
And we hope to do more this year. I've got $30,000 worth of children's rides if we can afford it this year. Because we want to continue to make it bigger and better. It was actually written up in Southern Living as one of the top festivals in the state.
It was well attended.
Yes. And we're having the same band. I mean, I cut costs as best I can. And I'm continuing to look at ways to cut costs.
It did good. We enjoyed it. The kids love it. We knew without the power.
Darling, do we need a motion to approve the funding request?
Can I get a motion?
Is that what we ask them for?
What are you funding?
Tell them what
we're
asking for.
$15,000. Huh? We've given the chamber the last 4 years $15,000 each year for the Freedom Fest. We've been one of the anchor sponsors. I think until the county started their hospitality tax, we were the largest sponsor, but I believe the county matches it now. They did.
Well, we're asking this year. And one of our large sponsors turned me down this year. So we're scrambling.
Well, we can all see it. I've been at eight for 4 years. We can all see the benefits, but I know 98% of them. It benefits everybody, so that's something we can do.
And we're hitting them up with Open House Darlington on May the 10th. Then we're doing Freedom Fest, so it's going to be bam, bam.
Okay, can I get a motion?
We need a thumbs up.
I'll motion that we approve $15,000. I'll motion it.
Okay. Second.
Okay, any more discussion? It's been properly moved and seconded that we fund the $15,000 that we've been doing the last 4 years for the Freedom Fest. All in favor?
Aye.
Nays have the same right? Motion carried.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you.
Great job. One of our own, Mr. Lee Andrews, baseball and softball. Come on up. Come on down.
I won't take much of your time. I just wanted to talk a little bit about baseball and softball. It was last month, well, about 2 weeks ago, we had a press conference announcing that we were going from Dixie and Little League to one league in Darlington, and that was Little League. And, you know, 2 or 3 days prior to the announcement, well, really the whole week probably prior to the announcement. There was a lot of stuff on social media about how that was a fail. And then we wouldn't get anybody signed up and all this stuff going around. And I just wanted to report the numbers for sign-ups tonight. In the past, there's been about 217 kids at Dixie and probably 117, give or take a few here or there at Little League. At the end of business today, we had 283 kids signed up just for baseball.
Right now. Good job.
And we had 135 girls signed up for softball. So if you do the math, we're over 400. And everybody was worried about people leaving and going to different places and playing. They're here. They're here. So just keep that in mind tonight when you make your vote. Blue Street is not going to hold us. Blue Street, right now, with what we have outgrown it just on parking alone. So we got to keep that in mind when we're doing this. It's going to be fun this year because it's going to be crowded. They're not going to have to travel if they don't want to because we're going to have enough teams. And when I did the numbers today, we got enough for probably five or six teams in the 3- and 4-year-old group, five or six teams in the 5- and 6-year-old group, five or six teams in the 7- and 8-year-old group. I mean, it's unreal how people have come out and done that. So one league right now, we're heading in the right direction. Just wanted to bring you an update on that because there were certain people out in the community said it wouldn't work, that it wasn't going to happen. Well, so far, so good. So I'll come back at the end of baseball season and tell you how good it was.
Thank you. Made a job. That's great. Okay, I'm finished with this. It's a sad article. We got tape of that one because
we have to have a public hearing for this because it involves a fee. So we have to have a public hearing on that in April. So that's why we're tabling that at this time.
Okay, new business. Proposed historic district, especially on Oak Street and Null Street.
Ms. Brock.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to also recognize the chairman of the Historic Landmark Committee, Kay Pearson, is here as well. She can help answer some questions if y'all have them. The City of Darlington Historic Landmark Commission would like to expand our residential historic districts. We have 3 residential historic districts and 2 commercial historic districts. This would extend the protection of the historic district and keep more of the character in our beautiful homes and neighborhoods. They feel that this will enhance the city by capitalizing on what Darlington has going for it, its place as a charming historic town. This initiative was started by a homeowner's request at the corner of Oak and North Streets, the large brick building, I believe, I don't know the man's name. And all their research that the commission has done is based on the state survey of the properties. And we've identified several areas that we would like to extend the districts, and the commission members have been volunteering, knocking on doors, physically talking to these neighbors to see if they want to participate. At this time, the commission is proposing to expand the Cashewa Spring District by adding the properties along North and Oak Streets. This would be on North Street from Evangeline all the way to Spring, and then on Oak Street till you get to the nursing home and Ms. Kerrigan's house. This would add an additional 15 properties to that district. And the commission also thought this would be a good time to expand this section, given council's recent concerns about protecting that particular neighborhood in recent months. Committee members have been in contact with homeowners about the benefits of being in a historic district, and some of those were included in your packet that was mailed out to you earlier, and I can certainly email those to you. Once they are added to the city's historic districts, we plan to assist homeowners in applying for the state recognition so that the tax credits will be available to them for major improvements. Currently, there's sort of 2 levels of this. You can be in the city's historic district and that's great, but it doesn't necessarily apply to state and federal. That just means the Historic Commission will oversee. Both of these applications can happen at the same time. This is what we need y'all's permission to do. We will help these homeowners fill out the applications. The state already did a survey for us, so we have almost all of the information to fill out these forms to get this listed on the National Register. This will open up the opportunity for these homeowners, just like all the homeowners in the residential district, if they have improvements that they need to make to their homes that are $15,000 or more, and if you have a historic home, you know that's pretty much every improvement you have to make. If it's anything large, you know, windows or roofing or redoing a porch or doing siding, as long as you're keeping the historic character, you do a little bit of extra paperwork and you get a 20% tax credit. And that's a 20% tax credit, not a deduction. So if you spent $100,000 on your house, you get $20,000 written off your taxes. That's a good deal for a little bit of paperwork. So that's something that we want to definitely help these folks do. And of course, for us, it benefits our town because as long as people are keeping up their properties, and that is our historic charm, that's helping everybody's property values and helping the town. So with your approval, we will proceed to notify the property owners. We'll have to have an ordinance, and first reading and second reading, but we did want to get your approval before we move forward and sending proper notification to all the property owners, certified letters, etc., that we would have to do before we presented y'all with an ordinance.
Everybody on here, they have already been notified certain things that they have to do up under the historic.
The only difference between the main thing is with living in the historic district, basically, for the city's perspective, is the exterior.
Okay.
We want it to maintain the character of the historic period that the house was built in. So if it's, replacing things that, if you're having to make repairs or replacements, to replace things in the same kind, color, etc., of what would have been done in that era, or if you have photographic evidence or some other evidence that the house was built with a staircase going off the side or something like that. So if you have a shingled roof, you put shingles back. If you have a wood siding, you put wood siding back. And it's really not as complicated as sometimes realtors seem to make it. And we've met with some realtors and tried to explain this to them as well. So that they're not scared showing our historic properties, because they're beautiful properties. They may need a little TLC, some of them, but they can be really wonderful showpieces. As far as getting the tax credits for the state, this is all filtered down from the federal U.S. Department of Interior rules. We're all using the same rules. It's got to, you know, keeping with what was in character at the time. To go get your tax credit, before you start work, you fill out the paperwork with the state. They approve it. They send it up. The feds rubber stamp it, essentially. Send it back down. You get the work done, like they say. You should get it done. They come back and look at it and say, yep, you did what you said you were going to do. It's still keeping in character. You're approved. Here's your letter so you can file your taxes. So that's kind of the process in a nutshell.
Any other questions?
Yeah. I just want to, I guess I need a little clarification. And this was, and maybe things have changed considerably since I was dealing with this. But being a member of St. James United Methodist Church, we had to get our, what would have been the old parsonage declared an historic building, and being that some parts of that area is supposed to be historic, that kind of thing. But when it came to the building, because changes had already been made, then it didn't seem to meet the standards. So in this situation with so many houses, 15, I would imagine that there's already been upgrades, repairs, or whatever. Are we sure that that's already meeting these standards?
From the exterior, obviously, we can't just walk into somebody's home. And most of the folks that want this tax credit are really wanting it for roofs and if they've got to redo siding. And that almost always gets them over the $15,000 mark, and they'd love to have some of that money back. it, as far as if you become part of the district, these are houses that were already identified in the state survey as fitting into this, into the district, based on the standards. And these are federal standards. Now, for example, the, and I think maybe this is an example, maybe other people have seen the post office, the old post office on the corner.
Mm-hmm.
Is not historic, because in the 70s they changed so many things inside. But because it's a public access building, you can see those changes more readily. As far as the interiors of these homes, it's a little more difficult for us to say
but
that.
See, that's what I'm saying, along the way, we need to know that up front, right?
Well, that will be included in their, in the packet that we send to get them on the National Register through the state. For the city's purposes, our ordinance does not include anything on the interior. The city's ordinances don't include interior for residential properties. So if you want to put in a fancy modern kitchen in your old historic home, the city can't tell you no, because we don't have jurisdiction over that. But if we, if you were to apply for the state and federal tax credits, the state and federal government would say, yeah, you need that to be historic looking, not a modern kitchen. So that's where the line is drawn. For our purposes, we're concerned with the exterior, what people see when they ride by or when they walk by or bike by. And that's our main concern, is to make our town look, continue to have that historic look on the exterior.
I got two questions. One of them is, you spoke of some, that it would be protection for the people in the district. What do you mean when you say protection of the people?
That they will continue to have that, the look, the character of the neighborhood. If you go down Broad Street where there's all those Reese houses, that is some kind of character that you can't just find in any neighborhood. And there's a value to that, to your property. And if this area is protected, not just one house, but the area, you're going to have that continuation of character, which improves your home. As opposed to, you know, somebody tears down their house and puts something very, very modern looking next to your antebellum home, it's going to look very strange. Probably not going to be great for your property value, because how would that look as you're passing down the street, the jarring of the aesthetic. And that's kind of where that, you know, goes.
How does that relate to the person who's next door to the historic district, who wants to put up their Frank Lloyd Wright home?
We don't have jurisdiction over that if they're not in the historic district, so.
A couple of houses on North Street that are smaller rental properties.
Mm-hmm. Those are the folks that we had a little trouble getting in touch with. And I know, do know that one of those properties, the second house after you, on if you're on North, after Oak Street, the first small house after that brick house, recently sold in the last few months. So obviously we've got to go talk to that person. And obviously if we know that you guys would approve of moving forward this project, all of the property owners will get certified letters detailing this.
St. James Parsonage Church is one of those houses.
St. James, 115 North.
It's the old Presbyterian part. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. That's the house.
That's in the corner.
It's different.
I'd like to ask.
It's not the same as
the St. James Parsonage, former Presbyterian parsonage on the corner of the Vans Line and North. It's right next to a nice old home. In itself, it's probably built in the 50s or 60s.
I'd be interested in a description of the addresses so that I know which homes we're talking about, because I'm not familiar with this enough to look by the dark area that's been highlighted. And then I also have an interest in, I want to protect these homes, but in the same, if we go down Broad Street as you referenced and go a little too far, you can see homes that haven't been kept up as much. on. And if we put too many restrictions on it, then I worry that we're not actually going to be able to afford to keep up the homes. So there's a,
I think there's a certain amount of misperception about what being in the historic district is. And I've gotten this when I've talked to realtors who said, oh no, this house is in a historic home, this is a historic home in a historic district. I'm like, well, what do you want to do that you think is going to be a challenge? What do you think the challenge is? The challenge really is the perception of the challenge. Because, okay, you want to paint your house. Well, there's paint companies have several lines of historic colors now. You don't even, it's very easy to find a color. And there's a nice palette of colors to choose from that fit the historic character of these homes that's easy to access. It doesn't cost twice the price. It's just...
I'm not opposed to this, but it would be a challenge to offer someone to pay $40,000 or $20,000 or $50,000 in wood siding whenever they can go to a vinyl. So it may be an economic challenge for some people in our community with a median income of $19,000. And that's what I worry about. That being said, I want to protect the historic homes. That neighborhood is very worried about the encroachments of the businesses around that. And I want to protect them from that. Just want to make sure we do it smartly. And I want to know which properties I'm doing it to. And right now, I just don't.
Ms. Rock, tell them what happened some years ago when the family wanted to change the roofing on the house, and it was a big to do with the
I don't know if I was here at that time.
You remember that?
Is that the house in St. John Street?
Yes, they wanted to change the roofing on it. I mean, because of the other roof, that, the logo was very expensive.
You're talking about a Spanish tile roof?
Spanish tile roof, yes.
And the Spanish tile roof of this particular house cost about $120,000, but the family didn't have the money to replace it. So the Historic Commission, this is 2008. They voted to make them replace it in the front, but they could put a regular roof in the back, which didn't make any sense to a lot of us, but it was going by the ordinance. The ordinance says that the historic property, you have to make improvements on the property if it's visible from the street. Well, this part of the roof was visible from the street, but the back part was not. So...
And there is a section of the ordinance that does deal with economic hardship that they can make exceptions based on that.
And the homeowners, they already know this.
Now, whether they know it or not is we don't know. They should be disclosed. That should be disclosed by the realtors, but we can't guarantee that in any way.
But did you contact any ones on the streets that you have shown them?
These almost every person has been personally contacted.
And you told them that.
And they were. The people on this street are the people who came to the people that are on the historic commission and asked for that protection to be extended. And that's the only reason that we brought this particular section to you. The survey that was done by the state actually suggested adding more than this, further down Broad Street and Edwards Avenue and several other areas. But those property owners on Edwards Avenue and Broad Street were not interested. And so that's why this is the only thing that we're bringing to you.
Any more questions?
I don't have any opposition to it as right now. I would like to know what the addresses are. It seems a couple of council members would like to know the actual physical addresses, because we don't recognize where these blocks are.
So the shaded area on this map of the homes you're talking about.
Now, just for your reference too as well, the historic district on Spring Street, these houses here are already in the historic district. All this is historic district already.
And that's mostly the first block of Spring you're talking about?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Could we get a map of the actual historic district in this area with the addresses of the proposed historic district included? That way we can have a fair representation of what we're doing.
We just wanted to know how we should move forward, if we should proceed with an ordinance or not at this time.
I'll look at some on that question the council had.
This may or may not be appropriate, but I'm puzzled somewhat by the tile roof house and the hardship type thing. At this point in time, is it the historical commission that determines whether a hardship is going to be allowed?
If you were to have a historic home in the district and you want to make a change, you are trying to do something different than what is there. So say you have the Spanish tile roof and you want to go to architectural shingles, which will completely change the look of the house. Because of that being a change, you go to the historic commission to get permission to do that. And when you present your case, you can present your case that you do not have the means to complete this in the way, and that is up to the historic commission.
Currently, does that final decision lie with the historic commission or an appeal to the courts, or is there a provision where if the historical commission does not allow it, it comes before city council?
Mr. Miller, the decision is up locally to the landmark commission, and it's not something that can be appealed directly to city council. We're going to have to go to the circuit court.
And the economic hardship, that would be done to the historic commission?
Yes, sir.
And that would be in your petition to the historic commission to say, I really need to change this because I can't afford this. And they would probably want some sort of proof of, as to why.
So if council wanted input, we would need to make that change in the ordinance as well?
Correct. Something else council should know too. Maybe we need to revisit all of and educate council members as to where our historic districts are and how many houses that we have in our historic districts, because we have a commercial historic district. We have a partial historic district on the square. Mm-hmm. We have historic districts for the St. John's area. Okay. Or West Broad Street, East Broad Street, and then there's the Spring and Cashel Historic Districts. Altogether, there's probably more than 150 properties that are listed
in totality.
Yep, there you go, close to 200 now.
Okay.
That's it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Laverne Moody, sidewalk repair on North Main Street. Mr. Moody?
You have to excuse me, Your Honor, and members of the council. I have a property at 433 North Main Street. The people was had dug up the sidewalk. It looked real, real bad. It happened about 4 months ago. I assumed somebody was going to call my attention to it as well. But it's tearing up people's car where they dug it up. I understand that AT&T had hired some Mexicans to fix it. But he stopped right there at my property, and mine is dug up now. I don't know what to do. I believe I contacted the wrong people at the time. I should have contacted the bill department and get them to do something. I've talked to you. I've talked to Mr. Garland, talked to him about a month ago, and he didn't know who had done it. Am I right?
No, sir, I think I told you it was AT&T that had the work done.
No. You didn't know who it was? Yeah. But anyway, I need your help to get this repaired. So excuse my enunciation and pronunciation. I don't think it's too good, but because I had several strokes. And right now I'm taking therapy. I won't take any more of your time. If you will help me on this.
Mr. Garland, can you get the lawyer to write a letter to AT&T?
AC, we've been in contact with AT&T within the last week. They said they're going to have everything repaired, including the sidewalk in the area in front of Mr. Moody's property by April 15th.
April 15th, Mr. Moody.
Good.
April 15th.
April 15th. And I thank you for coming.
I thank you very much for your time. Am I excused now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Moody.
How's that?
Thank you.
We're going to get it done.
We'll help you out, Mr. Moody.
Okay. Hello, thank you. Hey, thank you.
Second reading on the ordinance, 2018-02, purchase of property 165 Wakers. Court of Old Florence Highway, new deed. Can I get a motion for that?
So moved.
I'll second.
Second. Any discussion?
Purchase price 161.5, just to note that.
Is it on here?
No, ma'am.
No, okay.
That's why.
Anyway, all in favor of the motion, let it be said aye. Nays? Discussion on the record. Okay, motion carries. Second reading of order 2018-3, purchase of Wells Stadium ball field and tennis court from Darlington County School District for $100,000.
So moved.
I'll second.
Any more discussion? All in favor? Nays have the same right, motion carries.
Nay.
Nay, okay, one nay. Motion carries. Okay, second reading on ordinance 2018, purchase of playground for $80,500 on 207 Cicerone Street. All in favor?
I'll make a motion.
Make a motion.
I'll make a motion.
I'm so exhausted. Second, okay. Any more discussion? Okay. All in favor? Okay, nays have the same rights. I was pushing it on.
I appreciate
okay.
that.
Okay. Okay, Brian. First reading on the orders of 2018-5, annexation 164-0502-00, North Main Street, beside Downtown Amusement Company, out near where the post office is on the side of that, where used to be the what the place? The music company. It's the older music company. Right beside there, they want to put another Dollar General.
Oh. Hallelujah. I keep telling them where to put it.
Huh?
And I told them where to put the thing.
This is where they want to put it. You spend their money where they want to spend it.
That area is underserved.
It's underserved.
You've got a spring marsh and you've got a convenience store there, but if you live in North Darlington, you have to go back to downtown. You have to go back to downtown or out on the bypass to do any shopping. So that's one of the reasons why we're not located there. They feel like they have a market.
I got the perfect spot. They won't listen to me.
I'll motion to approve.
You make a motion?
Second.
Any discussion? Probably move in second that we have the first reading on the North Main Street. The Dogs Amusement Company, all in favor, lift the sign aye.
Aye.
Nays have the same right. Motion carries. Another Dollar General coming. Almost. Another week. Okay, bank the truck.
Everybody's using.
Madam Mayor and Council, we have a proposal from United Financial, which was in the council packet. They've given us three options for funding the Vector truck. You should be in the back of your handouts.
You'll be in the back, right?
What's the other bag? There it is. here. We recommend going with option number three, which is 10 payments consisting of $44,216 a year. Works out to roughly $460,000. We suggest that we split the cost between the water sewer department and street sanitation department. We do need this. The jet vac truck helps all of Darlington. And as far as staffing is concerned, we'll have to address that with our new budget after July 1st. It's also suggested that we put in an order for a jet vac truck, but we don't have it delivered until July, so that way the first payment wouldn't be due, not next budget year, but next year after. So that's kind of what we're looking at. It's sorely needed. We talked about stormwater so many different times, and while we're getting ready to move ahead with a multi-million dollar project for part of town, this helps, again, all of town. So that's what we're recommending.
And the water that they have in front of Hardy's and Joe's Grill and open that area around the square, does that suck, that's for sucking that out when the time comes?
It can be done for that, but it can also clean out the storm line. Yes, ma'am. Mr. Kinsall, you want to talk about a little bit what the machine can do?
The machine, the truck is what's called a combination truck. It's a vacuum truck, and it has a high-pressure jetter, which is what we clean sewer that with. Now we have a small trailer unit. You can feed the jetter down the sewer line, and it washes all the debris, the dirt, and stuff out of the line. And the vacuum part of it, these catch basins where the landscapers blow all the debris and all the dirt and everything goes into and accumulate, is you actually vacuum out those catch basins and collect all your debris that's in the storm drain. And we use similar on some sewer cases when we have a lift station down. We have to have them vacuumed out or cleaned out before we can work on a pump or whatever.
Well, when it's sucking, where does it go? Does it go? It's a tank in the truck, or you have something separate beside it?
Yes, no, it's a big tank on the truck.
Big tank on the truck.
Yeah, it's everything self-contained in the truck, uh-huh, like a garbage truck, and then they'll have to go somewhere and the back opens up and dumps out.
And it dumps.
Liquid or like sewer we take out to the waste treatment, other would have to be dumped somewhere around the street department or somewhere and disposed of it in landfill or somewhere.
So it can't be mixed?
No, you want, don't want sewer. You don't want sewer with it because everything would be contaminated and would be sewer.
Right, right.
But it's a useful truck. Every city pretty well has one. Staffing it will be the hard part that we're going to have to work out.
Okay, your capital in the water department, how much will come out of that?
Well, I'll budget half of this out of my just fund budget.
The same
20 something thousand same a year.
For
we can,
same for street?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. We can put that budget that in the water department. But I just paid solar septic tank $3,500 for a one day job. So
one day job. How far did
they
go with that?
I'll have to just suck out one lift station.
This one lift station?
Yep, while Frankie worked on a lift station, we had to keep a truck there, one of his trucks there. He stayed there all day, so it cost $3,500.
Where will we keep that truck?
Park it down at the street department.
Mr. Kinsall, how many times a year do you use someone like Sellers, and how much money does that cost on average?
I've used them so far in this budget year six times, and that's probably $7,000 that I've paid Sellers. Like I said, that one day was $3,500. And he gave a break on that. He said his normal charge would have been $5,500. He didn't see charging the city that much money.
Hey, a good example of this, too, is the inclement weather that, inclement's not a good word, but the disastrous weather we had in 2015, 2016, where the Allen Street station overflowed, we would have had the capability to go in there and clean that out ourselves instead of having to beg for somebody to come in and work.
And we had to get a truck to come in and keep sucking out, try to get that flow down to keep it back in.
Mr. Garland, you are proposing that we take delivery in the 18-19 fiscal year and make payment in the 2019-20?
Correct.
Do we get the same price?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Any other questions?
I do. I have a question.
Uh-huh.
Is I'm looking at a cost factor. I think I asked a question last month about the use of the truck that we're actually bringing an outside service in to use the truck. And I think I'm looking in my notes from last month when I asked the question, say we use it from maybe 5 to 10 times a year, anywhere from $3,000 to $4,000. So if we use it 10 times a year, we're talking about paying an outside service and $40,000. So
it depends on how much. And like I said, that was an all day that I had sellers out. His agreed charge, his negotiated charge was $3,500.
So even at $7,000, and we use it on an average of 10 times a year, I'm trying to see between purchasing a truck that we're only going to use from about 10 times a year,
well,
$400,000.
What you want to do, and right now it's going to be cut, is to staff it where it's running more or less about every day doing stormwater cleaning.
That's yeah, where we have to start
putting our stormwater. That's where our advantage is.
What you're figuring, Bruce, is what the sewer department's using.
Emergency use.
Yeah, this is on a have to have. But the storm drains that aren't being cleaned out or that are full of debris, is if we could get a crew to staff it, then that's where
the real use would come. So the last month was just on sewer?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Those figures are my figures coming out of my sewer budget.
Okay.
And no cost on the storm drain, because nothing's been done other than the one occurrence right there at the Main and Hampton at the Fitness World Printing Shop when they cleaned that one drain out.
And so you're saying that if we start cleaning out all the storm drains, and we will come up to $400,000 a year with all people coming to do it?
It will. Yeah, it would be a lot of use if we could run this truck, get the crew to run this truck several days a week, clean the storm drain. And you'd never get through.
And you said so the problem would be the staffing. Why would it be hard staffing?
You're going to have to hire 2 people.
So
at least 2 people, and they have to have CDLs and commercial driver's license.
I would suggest we hire one water and one street.
One street.
So we split the cost amongst different.
That's the harder part of the budget than the $44,000 that's come up with, because with what you're going to have to pay these people with the benefits, you're looking at 2 to 3 times what that truck payment's going to be.
So the money's not in there for the budget?
No, the money's not in there, like I say, until we come up with some creative in the budget session. So
that may have been the fact as to why you hadn't done it. I'm just saying.
Oh, that's a lot of it, yeah. It's staffing. I mean, the truck's a wonderful piece of equipment, but you put $400,000 sitting there, if you can't use it, it's not. As Ms. Bruce was saying, I mean, it might be better to rent one. Or lease one when you need to hire one when you need it.
Street sweeper is an example too. We have a $200,000 street sweeper, but Kendrick runs it maybe 5 days a month.
And you want a dedicated crew that's going to take care of this truck, you know, a $400,000 truck.
So the storm drain lines that's draining into the ditches that haven't been cleaned out in 30, 40 years, how's that going to benefit that area? What are you
going to
do about the ditches?
It won't help the ditches, but as the mayor's emphasis, the Hardy Broad Street area at Hardy, if you clean that drain all the way out, that drain drains into a ditch at Groveville Cemetery. So if you can get it there, the water's running some. I mean, the ditch is not going to flow, it's grown up, but it will take, but if you can clean that pipe out to get it to that ditch, you will help. It won't be 100%, but it'll be an improvement.
Right now, our stormwater pipes are falling to the top with debris. I can show
the
you.
One on Main Street, one on Main Street at Hampton, they dug out over 3 foot of the hard debris in that catch basin, so the water couldn't even get to the pipe.
I understand that, but once you clean all that out, that water's going to drain into South Darlington.
Yeah, and it's
so
not
those
going
ditches anywhere. Are not flowing or clearing out, then all that water's going to sit in South Darlington.
Because the county dropped their project, so it's not going to drain on out. But all we're trying to do is get it off the streets or get it out of downtown.
That
at the same issues.
Yeah.
We're still dumping it in South Darlington.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, technically, wouldn't that be dumped behind Greenville?
It depends. There's 7 outfalls away from the city. The ditch that's going to go, that's going to go into an outfall behind off Winston down off near the old cotton mill was into Swift Creek. The Hardy, the Broad Street area there runs into the ditch and it's going to run down to Swift Creek off Old Arlington Road, Old Farms Road. So there's a lot of areas that will drain. But yeah, I mean, if you get to the bypass, there's nowhere to go.
Do you have a map of all the storm drains over the city of Dalton?
Nobody. We've got partial in the stormwater study that Ms. Latham did. There's some maps as far as a, I won't say there's a real detailed, accurate map, total map.
But don't you think we may invest in this?
Well, we know where a lot of them. I mean, like I say, stormwater study's got a lot of them.
Because see, I heard you said you was going about the downtown area. We're getting sucking the water out the downtown area. What about the storm drains all over the city? You need to go and try to clean them out.
What you want to do is work a street, say Broad Street.
Yeah.
You work all the way to the end, and then you go to Hampton.
Just
you, you strategically work these streets.
But you need to know where they are first. Yeah. You need to know how many you have first before we get.
Hallelujah.
Do a little bit more research.
Hold up. I'm sorry. Please, council, please reconsider this. This is something that the whole city can use. This is something that every stormwater pipe we have in the city, every wastewater, we use this. We can use this. I promise y'all, we can have 5 years. I mean, how many years could they run every day until they catch up? How many years could you
have? They're figuring a good, I mean, they're willing to finance with 10 years to life. You know, it should run 10 years.
How many years do you think we could go before we get back to the first pipe we started on?
A long time.
How many years? Just give me an estimate. I know you
5 to 10 at least, probably.
So we can go 5 to 10 years, day after day, cleaning out our pipes, and we think we need to wait to figure out which pipes we need to clean first?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying I know it's a good thing. We need that, but I'm just saying we need to know how many storm drains do we have over the city.
I don't think that we need to know how many storm drains we have over the city before we figure out if we need to start cleaning them. I think we need to start cleaning our ditches and then figure out where our stormwater issue is.
It should have been cleaned.
But if we're worried about our stormwater issue,
we
need to worry about not having an actual comprehensive stormwater plan that includes our whole city.
But I think we do have a 5-year plan.
We don't have a plan that covers the whole city. If you live on the other side of Swift Creek, where we are right now, you're not included in our stormwater plan.
That's not true.
That is a fact. And please get...
Hold it. Let's stop. The stormwater plan that I saw, it was for the whole city. I don't know where you got that from. It was for the whole city.
I will be happy to provide all of council and Jenny Latham a map that shows where we have a stormwater plan and where we don't. You do not have a stormwater plan that includes the country club, that includes Oakdale, that includes anything like Springmart or that other side of Spring Street from the creek from where we stand.
Mr. Gunn,
you don't.
But does this truck will address those areas?
It will address every area in the entire city.
But that's what I'm saying now. The areas that we are so concerned
about.
Ms. Reed is talking.
Because of the situation in the area that we're working on, our stormwater big project that we have, I do see the value in what in the truck. Really, I do. Because everybody that has those flooding, whatever area you're living in, that we want it done. And I'm not opposed to nothing. I just see the opposition when you got, when I see the opposition to our present Southwest Darlington stormwater project, then we come with the truck to eliminate that. It's like, where was this idea prior to do? I've been on council, what, now a year and a half? I'm just saying, and now it's just coming, and from what I'm hearing you say, the truck been...
I'm not stormwater, I'm sewer.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Sewer's what I'm in trouble for.
Okay. So we good.
Let's go.
I think we need both of them. Let's just leave that.
Thank you, Elaine.
I would ask the council consider this strongly. And I'm in favor of doing the Southwest Darlington Stormwater Project, but I'm also in favor of doing something for the rest of Darlington now, and it's in your capability to do this now. And I want to help out Southwest Darlington to get that project completed in a timely manner, but I also want to show the rest of town that we're going to be willing to do something to help them out also. We worked in Southeast Darlington with the help of Ms. Latham and others on that $1 million improvement project for Ms. Backus is in Mr. Cannon's area. We're working in Southwest Darlington now. These things take years to do, as some of you have found out. But the Vactor truck is something we can do in the next year. And you can see concrete results on it. Because in 2007, we had a company come in and we paid them $40,000 to clean out the area of Spring and Casher Street in front of Shaw Darden's house. That area has never had any flooding since. That's just one area. That was $40,000. And it was a high jet cannon, the same type of machine we're talking about buying right now. So I implore council to approve this and let's move forward with ball fields, let's move forward with stormwater, and let's move forward with getting the Vactor truck.
Let the record show that when I was talking, I was not saying that I didn't want it. I just want to be sure that when we get it, we use it the right way. You can go to water use it. I think you jumped me before time. And I know we needed, I said that long time ago before you ever got on council, that we needed something to help out because that water has been downtown for over 60 years, older than you are. It was here before you got here. But we need it, but I mean, I just want to know that we're going to use it for what we said we're going to use it for. That's all I'm saying. Because you say you got the sweeper, use it 5 times a month. That's not enough.
Well, that's the reason I say you.
So that's why I brought that up.
The truck's only part of it. You got to have a good crew to work.
Right.
But Mr. Garland, you just said something that concerns me, and I don't think we need to be making decisions tit for tat. And like I was asking Ms. Kinsall for as far as a cost factor, if you gotta show the other side of town that we're gonna do something for them. Because we're going to do something on the south side with a stormwater project. All of a sudden, here comes a Vactor truck that should have probably been purchased 30 years ago.
We did have one.
So this water project is nothing that just happened overnight or 2 years ago. It's almost like we're doing something tit for tat. And that doesn't sit well with me. And I want to do what's right for the city. But don't do something tit for tat. Okay, nobody was concerned about what I need to explain to the people on the south side of Darlington why we need to get something for them because we did it on the north side of Darlington. That kind of concerned me, Mr. Garland, that comment you made.
The comment. The council members that were not here originally, when I came here, we did have an OVAC.
Right. I mean, I'm for it if that's what we need, but let's not, and you had a beautiful prayer. At the beginning of the meeting, a beautiful prayer, working together. So let's not make decisions tit for tat.
But no, I don't
think you intentionally meant that, but that's what I've heard.
I'm selling for sewer.
Yeah.
Sewer is what I need to truck.
And this is something that we truly
it's,
need.
It's not going to be hopefully once a week. I hope I don't need it once a week.
The point I want to make, and I want to be clear. If this is something that we truly need, then yes, then we need to get this. But if this is something we just want to do because we're doing something on one side and I got to make sure I please this side, then we're not doing what he said in his prayer when we started this meeting. And that concerns me.
We're going to need the back truck to keep when the stormwater project is completed, it's going to have drains. They're going to need to be cleaned out along with what we got.
Understandable.
So I'm making a motion that we go with option number 3 and hire the people that we need to operate this piece of equipment.
I'll second that.
I'll third it.
I had a
lady come in my office very upset with 382 West Broad Street Friday afternoon. She said for the last 4 years, whenever there's a large rain, she lives right around the curve from Edwards Avenue, that her house floods. She's off several heat pumps and had requested gut work multiple times, and she was going to sue the city if we didn't do something to help her and her neighbors out. She asked if the Southwest Darlington Stormwater Project would address the needs in that area, and I told her, I showed her the map. I said, no, ma'am, it does not. But I said, we have something that's on the agenda Tuesday night that may be able to help you by cleaning out the lines around the property where you live, right on that curve that floods so badly and everybody drives by it whenever there's a large rain, you see it, how bad it looks between Edwards Avenue and Clare Street on West Broad Street. And so I have these folks that come to my office monthly now complaining about the stormwater issues that they have in their neighborhood, and I don't have a good answer for them. So So that's kind of where that came from, Ms. Bruce, I just felt.
And comment, when I needed.
Vice versa, it doesn't matter if you're trying to tell the people on the south side, well, I need to take care of you, because the people on this side are going to say something. Vice versa, I'm not saying either way, but I'm just saying we don't, decisions not getting made like that. Comments, we got to be careful with comments and stuff that we say, because it can be perceived.
My need can come up in the middle of the night as an emergency, and finding a truck to hire is a lot of times an issue. You know, I can come in 2 days or 3 days, and if I got a sewer down, 3 days is going to be a catastrophe. If I need one, you know, within 3 or 4 hours, whatever.
I think we have a motion.
Mayor, we've had a motion and a second. I would ask that we call for a vote on the question.
Vote. I'm the second. Any more questions? All in favor, let me sign aye.
Aye.
Nays got the same right? Motion carried. Now, let's don't take this the wrong way. But I've been on council for 18 years. A lot of things that were going on then, nobody attempted to do anything about it. When I knew what was going on with the ditch, I pursued it. It wasn't a thing where I mentioned it one time. I kept on mentioning it over and over and over again. And so let's be, instead of what other people's feeling, it's not a thing where you want to do something over here and don't want to do anything over there. All of Darlington can stand between you. Not just the ditch, all of it. And with the back truck, we are hoping that we get all the storm drains. Because in the past, I have mentioned some of the storm drains in the area where I live. And then whoever cleaned them out, they just stay stopped up. So that's why I said what I said, Brian. Be mindful of where we have them and do what we need to do. Because that's too expensive equipment to just let to sit there. Thank you.
Thank y'all for approving that.
Okay.
H.
Adam DeWitt Christmas Festival.
After that discussion, I hope the Christmas theme will kind of lighten the mood or something. Good evening, my name is Ann Witt, and I'm here tonight representing the Darlington Rescue Squad. I'm sorry I only have two sets of the maps. I would like to present an idea for an annual Christmas festival and ask for the hospitality tax funding for it. As many of you know, Darlington Rescue Squad sponsors the annual Christmas parade. In 2017, a new committee took over the parade, and it was one of the largest turnouts I can remember. We had an awesome and challenging time learning all the ins and outs of our parade. After the parade was done, we had a week to recuperate, and then we sat down and went over the pros and cons. Some lessons learned were that we need more space for staging and a way to keep people downtown for the tree lighting. And from that idea, the idea of having a festival to tie the parade into the tree lighting came about. We have many ideas, but due to the fact that we are a small organization, we lack the funding needed to sponsor such an event. Here is where you come in. You have the money to fund our ideas. The annual Darlington Christmas Festival would kick off with the Christmas parade and close with the tree lighting downtown in Darlington. Some of our new ideas for this year would be for the parade to reverse our route, and that's what's shown on your map. This past year, 2017, we had a huge increase in participants in our parade. We used North and South Spain Street, North and South McCall Street, and we were overflowing with cars and floats. Horses, bands, the Shriners alone took up a whole street. So we're thinking of reversing the parade route, which would start and stage at Fitness World Gyms at the big parking lot. So it would start there, it would come down Pearl Street, around the square, down Cashua, and it would turn off on Spain Street. Now the cars themselves would just drive away, the floats would stop, pack up, and they would head back to wherever they came from. Adding more bands, I would like to see more music in our Christmas parade. A funding problem is a big issue for the bands, is why they do not come to our parades anymore. The school district does not give them fuel expenses for the buses, and they do not provide a driver for them to travel. The bands have to fund this themselves. So So we would like to offer the vans an amount of $300, which you see on your budget. That would get Hartsville Band and Lamar Band and their families to come to our Christmas Parade Festival. Affordable floats. Our floats are $450 a float to rent, and a lot of organizations can't rent them. We've been in talks with some farmers in our area, and we would like to get their trailers. We would like to have an area where the civic groups in our town can go and decorate their own trailers for a nominal fee of $50 opposed to $450. We have a golf cart contest in 2017. We had 5 golf carts. They were decorated awesomely, and the people are very excited about next year's golf, and I think we'll double it next year. And, of course, more music. I've been in touch with some of our churches. I would like to have choirs on some of our floats to sing our Christmas carols as they're going down the street. Some of the ideas for the festival, it would start with the Christmas parade. Once the Christmas parade came through the square and went off on Cashville, the festival would start on the square. I've been in contact with the Kiwanis, who does the Christmas tree lighting. At the same time that the Christmas tree is lit, we have been in contact with a fireworks company, and we will have 4 minutes of fireworks, which will also bring in people to our town for our Christmas parade. I would love to have a laser light show, which would be great. However, there is about a $5,500 price difference in having laser lights and having fireworks. Inflatable bounce houses. I've been in contact with Palmetto Inflatables. They said they would give us 3 bounce houses for 2 hours on the square, and I think it was $450 on your budget. Vendors selling Christmas themed desserts and beverages. We will not charge to have vendors on the square. However, there will be a very limited amount of vendors. We would like things like fried Oreos, funnel cakes, cotton candy, hot chocolate, and lemonade, things like that for the people to buy. I've been in contact with Darlington High School Choir and the Mayo Choir. They are both very excited about coming up and doing a presentation on the square after the parade goes through. We will have an MC for the event. I've been in contact with Tony Rogers. He does a karaoke. I think he's doing the karaoke for the community karaoke for Miss Rock. He will MC the event. He will also provide Christmas music between the choirs playing. I would also like to contact the stores downtown to have a shop small do that night. Since there will be so many people downtown, we'll have the stores open. People can eat, people can buy, visit. And then in 2019, we can do it this year, but in 2019, we're thinking of taking our parade and making it the end of the festival, which would be a nighttime parade, which I know draws people. We would have the floats with the lights on, so it would be the Christmas tree lighting to kick it off, and then the Christmas tree, Christmas parade to end the festival. So we have a lot of ideas, and we have a lot of people who want to volunteer their time to do it, but we just need the money to do it.
How much funds are y'all asking for?
We're asking for $10,000. Now, on your budget, it's around $6,000. Those things are just the things that right now we've talked about. We haven't even had our first meeting. That would give us a little leeway. It will be an annual event. We will do it every year, so what we have left over from this year will carry over to next year.
Well, let me ask a question. Who's the name of this organization?
Darlington Rescue Squad, which is your volunteer ambulance service in the city of Darlington.
So you guys took it over.
We've been doing it for years.
Oh, we have
a new committee. Our committee, which was Chief Kavanaugh's wife and Dwayne Wedford, they retired. They did it about 12 years and they retired.
So you guys have a different committee.
Yes, ma'am. We have a different committee.
Okay.
Whole new committee this past year. So we're hoping to bring people in by bringing outside bands and having the fireworks. We're hoping to bring people into our town and stay down there for two and three hours to have a festival.
In the same type of parade you had last year?
Oh, yes, ma'am. The parade will be the kickoff at 4 o'clock, and then the Christmas tree lights at 6:30, and then we'll have the fireworks, and then we'll wrap it up at 7.
Any more questions?
Mr. Carlin, when are we going to start our budget process?
I've been working on it the last 5 weeks.
I'm just thinking, Adam, we might need to have a budget meeting so we have some sense of how much of that hospitality tax money we actually have, and then when we see what we got, we'll make some type of commitment.
Okay.
And then we'll let you know.
I have a question.
Yes,
ma'am. And I'm truly... don't want to bring any negative connotation, but it was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed everything.
that group that had the Confederate flags.
I'm not sure which one.
A lot of people didn't really see it. I just would like a commitment that, because it is the Christmas and we are being aware of all of our citizens, that we, about the units that we do have, that you'll be aware of that and be sensitive to the different cultures in our city. That was my only concern, because it was beautiful. I enjoyed it. You did a marvelous job. I liked the participation, the many, everybody was quite excited. I saw some old friends that I'd worked with for years that was all out there. I didn't even know they was in Darlington. But the Christmas parade brought all that out. Mm-hmm. Christmas lighting, the tree lighting, everything was great. But I did want to mention that.
I'm not sure who you're talking about,
I hate to tell people they can't come
because of different things. Because then if that's one thing, then I can tell another group they can't come for something else, and I can tell another group you can't come for this. I hate to start that. I mean, I don't want anybody to be offended, but I also don't want to start down that path of you can't come because of this, or you can't come because of that, and you can't come because of this.
Can I ask that you work on somebody who can come and do Christmas carols as they walk down the parade?
Well,
I would love to hear that.
Well, actually, that's what we're talking to the churches about. Since we're going to get the floats from the farmers for so much of a cheaper price, $50 compared to $450, we're going to offer them to the different churches in our community so that they can get their choirs together and they can have their sing the carols as they ride down the road. I hate for them to walk a mile and sing a mile. That's a lot for them to do. But they will be able to sing on the floats. And instead of having, I think we had four floats including ours this past year, because they are so expensive, a lot of people can't afford them. But if the farmers get together and they can give me 10 floats, then I can have 10 floats that different organizations can decorate themselves. And make it a little bit more small hometown feel.
Mr. Cavanaugh, the 15 years your degree. 15, yes, well, have y'all ever had a Confederacy in the parade? I've never seen it.
Not to my knowledge, ma'am. Dwayne Weatherford and them were very, when they started the parade, watched people come through. But I can attest to them, these guys this year, it was so crowded this time, it was hard to control people coming in. Sometimes you would get someone diving off a side street and just try to get in. It was kind of hard.
Well, dude, they pay to get in, right?
Yes, ma'am. And we had signs set up, and we had a one entrance to come in off of Hampton onto Spain or Holland, Spain. We had one entrance coming in. But what happened was everybody came at one time. And then, you know, they're used to coming this way, so they came in these side streets, and we had little cards for everybody to put on their windshield that made sure you paid your fee. We had your registration, but they were just coming in so fast, and there were so many of them that, you know, our people were walking up down the road looking for those cards, but I'm sure they missed.
I was on, the city float was on Spain Street, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And I think you were standing right across on Spain Street, so when they came by, you were over there on the other side when the Confederacy came, and two cars came by.
I did not see that. I'm not sure who the group
wasn't
was.
Have time to take them out anyway.
Well, I mean, I don't know what the group was. I couldn't tell you. You know, people, when they sign up, especially in the cars. Now, the group, the dance groups, the bands, you know, we get a lot on those, but a lot of people just say, hey, this is John Smith, and I want to put a car in there for, you know, Miss.
But I'm just wondering, in the time that the fire department had it, what made it this year for them to come and rush in?
Well, the fire department's never had this Christmas parade. The rescue squad's always had the Christmas parade. We just had a different Christmas committee.
The committee was made of
people in the community. This past year, they retired, and we took it over in October. And Dwayne Weatherford was absolutely wonderful with us to sit down and go over with me over an hour of things that we needed to do for this parade. But I'm not sure about the group that you're talking about, and I'm not sure about, was it just a car, or was it a group of people?
It was two cars.
Was it part of the Shriners, or was it a, because the Shriners had about 10 different cars.
Something. Mm-hmm.
Wasn't it one of the old trucks?
One of the Shriners, I think it was a Shriners truck, yeah. If that's just what I'm thinking about. They looked like they were moonshiners or something, maybe.
Yeah, and then they had to do it. I'm just wondering why this year? Why was it last year, 2007, they never tried to do it before?
The Shriners have been in your parade every year.
I know that, and they've never done that before.
Unfortunately, I don't know if you know how the Shriners work, you email one person, and they email everybody, and whoever shows up, you have to give them a donation. So you don't know. I had no clue before they show up that they were going to be there. So as every group showed up, they got their donation, and they got in line.
I don't think you understand what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that all the other years, they never tried. I think you used probably some of the same procedures that you did then. Mm-hmm. Why is it this year they tried to pull in? I don't understand that. That's what I'm trying to understand.
If it's that particular Shriner group, then that's what probably they always do. I did not see them. There was just so many people funneling in to go into the parade.
I'm sure we
could ask. I suggest, because it was such a large parade. It's like when it got to the end, mm-hmm. I mean, like the sun was starting to set. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people started, there was a big gap in some part of it too. So people were leaving, thought the parade was over. And the only reason I stayed, because I knew the last group was the little girls and the dance group. And my grandbaby was in that group, so I stayed to watch that. But it was almost like, people was like, is it over? It's over. So, I mean, if we can do something, I don't know if we can start early.
Well, I can tell you what you can do to start to quicken the parade up, but you're not going to like it. And that's quit throwing out candy.
I
like that. and you know, unfortunately, that's something that we may have to move to due to the incident that happened last year.
Because there was a man that got hit.
Yes. That they were out in the street. They were not on the sidewalk. They were out in the street. A whole group of people. And when it got in front of the old Central Park, it went down to one lane. Mm-hmm. There were so many people on each side. And I think, hopefully, by, you know, starting at Fitness World, people will spread out more, you know, come up the hill by Subway, people will be spread out more and not have to be so far out into the street.
I think there are some cities that do that, too, from a safety standpoint. Mm-hmm. That might not
be a bad thing. Yeah. They do. Now, if it becomes a night parade, we will have to stop that. Now, one of the suggestions that we had was that if your particular group wants to throw out candy, that you have somebody walk beside your float near the edge of the street on each side and have a big bag and throw the candy away from the road.
Because
it is hard being on the float in the cars and you're in the middle of the road to toss candy that far. So maybe you have somebody dressed up like a little, you know, a little elf or something, Christmas theme with a bag and can throw stuff off to the side of the road. That would be a thing that we might have to look at.
But having it at night would be easier to stop it.
Yes. Yeah, and I think having it at night would also draw people with the lights.
You have to ask them, but you should put it out there. Mm-hmm. No candy this year. No candy. And if you have something around the square, then the kids can come in and get their candy.
Now, we will still have the Christmas parade this year. We will still have it. The Drawings and Rescue Squad will fund it. We will not be able to do the Christmas festival.
Board applications today, they're in your packet that was left on your chairs. The first nominee put forward by the committee is Miss Nancy Adcock. She lives on Spain Street. She works at the Raceway. She has a bachelor's degree in communications from the University of Alabama and is interested in serving on the park committee.
Who did you send out of here by that time? Who did you say?
Nancy Neal Adcock.
I'd like the motion that we approve Nancy Adcock to the Lambton Barge Board Committee.
Second.
All in favor?
And the second nominee brought by the Williamson Park Committee is Ms. Roseanne Brasington, who lives on Woodland Drive. She's a retired teacher, and she would also request to be serving on that committee. She had served on it in the past.
I'm looking that we approve Roseanne Brasington for the Williamson Park Board Committee.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Roseanne Brasington for the boards and commissions. All in favor, that must sign aye.
Aye.
Names have to say aye.
Aye.
Most
care.
Thank you.
Nine
report, no actions needed. Council comments?
It sounds like when the chamber was presenting its proposal that we're going to have an open house on May 10th, and people have a chance to look and drive around. I would ask Mr. Garland to make contact with Palmetto Paving this week and just tell them what we're trying to do on May 10th to see how their schedule is going to fit on their paving on Cashwa Street so that we don't run into a conflict. We got people coming into town and they can't get down Cashwa Street because it's being paved. So there should be some sympathy there for us because Palmetto Paving's senior group has a daughter that's married to one of our former residents. And so there may be some help in getting them to cooperate with us.
Have we given you a deadline yet, Mr. Scott?
They're supposed to start this month.
I think the mayor had discussed some issues about yard debris throughout the administration, and I'd like to also discuss it. I don't know how we're going to go about it. It looks like we had previously, council had looked at different ways of working on this, but I think we kind of need to revisit it. It seems that some customers or some citizens just aren't knowing that you can't not put refrigerators and, you know, beds and all kinds of stuff, sofas throughout the city. And so I guess the administration may need to readdress this. Maybe we need to do a public service announcement on our water bill, some way just to kind of educate the citizens. I mean, work from a finding standpoint, maybe. Residents can keep on doing this.
In the past, I'm sorry.
I have one more thing,
On this or something else?
Something else.
Okay. Well, anyway, on this, I actually tell the superintendent about that. And I told him to send a mixed signal to the customers because he would go and pick it up. He would send somebody to pick it up. And so people think now that we just pick up anything, but we don't. And so it needs to be revisited again, like you said, Brian, and we need to do something about it. But I think Mr. Garland, they set out Friday, and they picked that. He did a good job. Did he go over the city?
I don't know what y'all are talking about. I just in passing out the conversation.
Went and picked up everything that they could find. Friday on the street. Somebody called me and told me thanks for coming to pick it up.
Sanders had two couches that were delivered 2 days ago. And then a follow-up subject is sidewalks. We discussed previously about possibly doing some outside hiring or either hiring employees about grinding of the sidewalks. And my girlfriend about ate it the other night, and I would appreciate it if we could look into that. I know that this summertime's coming, we will be doing hiring for greenskeeping, and maybe we can hire one of those employees to go around the city and start grinding some of the street values. We got a serious liability, and I'd love for it to be addressed.
I got one thing. Mr. Garland, let me publicly say to you, job well done on the process we went through in hiring a new chief. What you did, you didn't have to do. You got council involved from the beginning. We went through all the resumes. We narrowed it down to the finalists. And then the decision was made. And then you got the public involved. So that whole process went off very well. So I want to publicly thank you for a job well done on that. So, outstanding job.
All right.
Yes.
So, two things. I want to say thank you to Mr. Garland as well for cleaning up our neighborhoods and getting all the trash off the street. But now I think it's time for council to step up and do our job. I think we need to improve or change our ordinance. Whereas to, instead of them not being unaware that they can't throw certain things on the street, we need to put orders in place that says this is what they can and can't do. And notify them of what they can and can't do, because now the streets look good, but if we don't do something fast, it's going to be back out there again. So we need to step. Trash has done their job. Mr. Garland has done their job. It's now it's time for council to do our job. Second, the new equipment that we just bought, the machine. I'm okay with buying the machine, but I want to see the machine working in all
of Darlington, not downtown only, not on the north side only. I need to see this machine in South Darlington, Southwest Darlington, everywhere, cleaning out drainages.
Very good.
I want to know if we can expand it a little further. We got some areas on Jefferson Street that I need them to visit. Can we go one more week? We can clean up one more week.
Anyway, I guess we need to address it. I guess this year, Mr. Garland, address it and see what we can do about it. We got to change it so people would know.
Yes.
We got to change it so people will know what we can pick up. I know we pick up televisions, but people put everything on the street. Mattresses, everything. And I think at one time we did have once a year during cleanup time that we would put, they would pick up tires. A lot of people don't know about that.
Pick up what?
Tires.
Tires.
And then I think April 28th is cleanup, right, Ms. Ross?
April 28th.
And I was trying to get all of Dollar to participate in it and see what I talked to Ms. Rhonda Brown about it. She called me about that. And see, can we get everybody to engage in their neighborhood, sororities, fraternities, everybody to pick a spot that they want to clean up.
Okay.
And especially it would be good for an elderly person that can't do some things themselves to help them. Or either, let's forget about I didn't put it out there. Let's help people. It's not going to hurt for us. A lot of people got trucks and go around and help the neighborhood get cleaned up. If you care about Dalton, let's clean it up. Not just the downtown area, in all areas. And Mr. Garland, before you start, anybody else got anything to say?
Can you bring your Cadillac over to my house? I got a couch a street over
there. I'll bring my truck. Bring my truck for you. Anybody else do a reminder before Mr. Garland finish? Monday, March the 12th, 2018, 6 p.m., we have the swearing-in ceremony for Chief of Police Kevin Washington. Tuesday, March 13th, we have a special meeting, Darlington City Council, first reading of the new Stormwater Bond. And Tuesday again, April 3rd, 6:30, regular meeting of Darlington City Council. Mr. Garland, want to pass out something, y'all.
This is the Stormwater Bond and the agenda for the meeting next Tuesday. It's a lot to read over. I wanted to give it to you plenty in advance so you have a chance to read over. Any questions, please call me tomorrow. Not tonight. Thank you.
All right. Okay, wait on that motion.
I make the motion that we adjourn.
I second.
Yeah.